anything but that!
Oh, sorry. It's the Guy, Sharyn and Clint podcast.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
Afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the show. Guy, Sharyn and Clint. Thank you for the feedback, Shazdon.
And Sharon's headphones. Woo!
That wasn't feedback. That was me bringing my clarinet in for my big clarinet solo that's coming up later in the show.
I love when you bring your clarinet in.
Tuning up for the big gig, guys.
Yeah.
I actually am the worst musician in the world, so you don't want to hear what I have to do.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
Not this segment.
It's time for...
We've got a friend and he's got a big mouth. Sometimes we wish he'd just shut up. So we're gonna put something in his face.
His big fat face.
Then you gotta guess what's in his mouth.
That was a new intro for a game we like to call what? Guys. Guy, open wide and insert.
Insert as many of those as you can.
Can I give a clue?
No.
Yes.
Oh. No.
My clue was just going to be that what is in my mouth today was purchased at a supermarket and costs $7.33.
There you go.
Okay, here it goes. This is disgusting.
I can smell them from here. That's one.
You looked quite good at that.
I want two.
One goes in, the other one falls out.
No, you can get them in.
You can get them over there. Oh, God, they smell.
Put them in a bunch.
This is the best one yet. What's in your mouth? Oh, God. He's got drool coming out of his mouth like a dog. What's in your mouth, guy?
You look like the pink guy. You like that pink guy off Futurama.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
0800 The Edge, what's in Guy's mouth?
Hayden, what do you think's in there?
Those balls that are pickles.
Not pickled balls. But thank you so much for calling. If you want to have a guess of what's in Guy's mouth, call us now. 0800 The Edge or text us to 3343.
One more time, mate. What is it?
It hurts.
What's
in
Guy's
mouth?
Guy's mouth is full to bursting point today with something we purchased earlier from New World. And we've got so many guesses, some on the text machine.
Frank, octopuses? Is it an octopus in there? No. Is it a frisbee? No, it's not that either. Okay.
Is it an autographed copy of Dirty Politics?
No. Let's go to the phones. Matt, what do you think's in Guy's mouth?
Is it green-lipped mussels?
Green-lipped mussels? No, it's not that. Sorry, Matt. Edward, what do you think it is?
I think it's kidneys.
Kidneys? Is it kidneys?
No, that'd be disgusting. Why do you think it's that?
Because I heard Clint say them, and they're usually arranged from... $10 for $7 at the supermarket.
It's not that. Linda, what do you think's in Guy's mouth?
Is it tampons?
No.
Hey, weirdly enough, that's not that bad a guess because we have actually already done tampons. And it's not tampons today, I'm sorry. Is that how much tampons cost? $7?
Well, it depends
what
you get.
Well, I thought it'd be around that, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Something like that. Renee, what do you think's in Guy's mouth?
Anchovies.
There's another text here. Is it a copy of Agent Cody Banks on VHS? No.
$7.99. Don't have a guess. I just wanted to flesh this out so that that we could shut him up for a little bit longer. Sam, what do you think is in Guy's mouth?
Is it sausages?
It is sausages.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, Sam. It is sausages.
I just spat three salty, cheesy sausages out of my mouth. It was Premier Cheese Kransky.
Not just any sausages, but delicious Kransky, Kransky. Sam.
Oh,
Sam
was so disgusting.
Guy's not
going
to eat them because he's a prude, but would you like us to send you the Kranskys as a prize?
Yeah, that'd be good, actually.
There you go, everybody wins.
In my mouth, you sicko.
We'll give you a decent prize as well, Sam.
I want the sealed packet.
Oh, no, we don't have a sealed packet. They're from the deli, they're the fresh ones. But we'll hook you up with the guy, Sharyn and Clint, prize pack, Sam.
Chuck me one of those. I'll eat the end that hasn't been in your mouth.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint. Edge.
Everyone has those moments. I think this is an unbelievable phenomenon. And this is something that...
Phenomenon.
This is something... Dun, 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 dun. This is something...
Phenomenon.
That,
dun, dun, dun,
dun. This is something that really haunts me all the time. It's like a memory from your childhood. It doesn't matter how tiny or small it is. It comes back, like, with a small trigger. Like, every time I go to McDonald's in Nelson,
yeah.
I strongly remember the time I was there. My parents were looking after a girl who I liked. We went to McDonald's, and my dad brought out the chicken nuggets, and I separated them with my hands evenly for me and her. Turns out they were just for her. And that was, believe it or not, embarrassing for me.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, that embarrassing moment embarrassed me so much when I was 5 years old.
Yeah.
That I still remember it now. I'm 26.
So you thought you were being a good guy, like, hey, I've got a crush on you. I'm going to make sure you get as many nuggets as I do.
Divvy them
up. Had you started eating them before your dad told you they were all for her?
No. All I did was just divide them up and told, no, guy, that wasn't the case, and had to put them back. That's all that happened. It was nothing. No one else would remember that. But for me at the time, my cheeks went red, and it embarrassed me.
Mm-hmm.
And it is mental illness. It is sickness. And I reckon everyone has this, when something little like that follows you for the rest of your life and you can't shake it.
Yeah. My one is that I will not use a toilet at someone's house or anywhere unless there's a lock.
Yeah.
I could be busting, and if there's not someone I trust there that can stand at the door, then I won't use
You've got a guard. You'd have a guard.
Because when I was... we were living in Waimate, so I must have been 4 or 5 years old, and we went out to our friend's farm, and I went to use the outhouse because it was an outhouse toilet.
Yeah.
And I went to just do a wee, and I was sitting there.
Good details, thank you.
And then the dad came, and I, because I was on the young, and he opened the door, and he was like, oh, will you finish? I'm busting. I've been out on the farm. And I was like, And then all the kids ran around. They're like, Sharon's in the toilet. So I had to get off the toilet, pull my little pants up, and be like, finish. And he's like, don't forget to flush. And so I like, flush. Ever since, I will not use a toilet unless there's someone I trust guarding the door or if there's not a lock.
See, Guy just divvied up some nuggets. Yours is traumatising.
It is traumatising.
You got harassed on the toilet by an old farmer.
No, but nobody would remember
it. That's enough to give you bladder issues.
It wasn't anything inappropriate or anything like that. But they were
not suggesting that it was. I'm not suggesting that it was.
But it was as everyone laughed at me, you know, and everyone saw my knickers.
It can be small.
Luckily, I had my DuckTales knickers on that day.
It can be...
They're real cute.
It can be small, it can be big, it doesn't matter. These things just, they come up and get... It's so weird. You could be at your wedding, or I could be at my wedding, and I'll still remember the chicken nuggets debacle, chicken nuggets gate. It won't matter.
Well, don't plan ahead to your wedding, mate. baby steps. It's all good, bro. Do you want to go and get some chicken nuggets after the show?
Honestly, at my wedding that morning, I made my maid of honour guard the door when I went to the bathroom because there were so many people in my suite. I didn't want anyone to like come in and be like,
scarred for life.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on the Edge.
We're doing industry super secrets like we do every Thursday, but we've put a little bit of a twist on it. We want to know the worst complaints you've ever received.
The funniest thing I've ever read when it comes to complaints is the feedback log that we get for the TV side of our company.
Yeah.
So it's like the news and all that sort of stuff. People will ring up and complain about the colour that Hilary Barry was wearing that night. Or, oh, I'm not sure I liked Hilary's jacket tonight.
Yeah.
Like, they actually take time out of their day to ring up and complain about what the broadcasters are wearing.
What do you think the complaint logs would have looked like when Mike McRoberts phased in his grey hair? I reckon they would have gone ballistic.
Yeah, people were ringing up and being like, what's going on with Mike's hair?
So 0800 The Edge, what are the secret complaints from your industry?
Christy.
Hi.
What's your industry super secret complaint line edition thing?
I am a colour consultant. So I had a guy that works at an undertaker came in.
What?
He works at a what?
An undertaker.
Undertaker. You know, like for these people.
Yeah, yeah,
so what does a colour consultant do? They advise you on the colours that you should wear in clothing?
I do it for houses and wall colours and all that.
Okay. Like an interior decorator, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, similar. And he was complaining that the people in the viewing room looked dead because of the wall colour.
Wow.
He was like, is this a joke? I'm not even serious.
Mm, people in a viewing room probably do look dead when they're dead.
They're dead, yeah.
I prefer if I'm going to view somebody that's passed away and say my goodbyes, I prefer they look a little dead rather than looking like they're going to be like, ha! Tricked
ya. They should hang them there like a puppet. They should support them.
No.
Honestly, that happened when I went to see my cousin. I was convinced that she was going to jump up and be like, gotcha!
Surprise!
She didn't, though. Tanya, what is yours?
Hi, I work in an ice cream factory, and we got a complaint that the ice cream was too hard.
Okay, it's frozen, right?
Yeah,
that is actually ridiculous. But I'm kind of, you know, I like to have a little.
Just
bit
leave it on the bench. Leave it on the bench for a minute.
Brad, you're a taxi driver. What's your complaint?
I used to be a taxi driver, but I had this one lady that was probably the last time I took someone. She complained that I was running stop signs and I was excessively speeding, and we found out at the end it was because I charged her too much.
Ah.
Yeah, no, it was an aha moment.
Were you doing all those illegal things though? Because that sounds like a pretty good reason to get fired as a taxi driver.
No, it sounds like a way to bring the bill down. If you're going that fast, the bill's going to be less. But
exactly.
All right.
Exactly, Linda, what's yours? Linda,
yeah. Linda.
Oh, hi. We're in the hospitality industry, and a guy came in one morning and he complained because the sun was shining in the bathroom window and he couldn't shave.
Oh, for goodness sake.
That's gold.
That is so annoying.
I know. I mean, if we could have moved the building, we would have.
I'll never forget my granddad went to Fiji and complained when he got back that it was too hot.
Too hot in Fiji.
Too hot in Fiji. You'd never believe it. I was yarning to a lady the other day who works for like a major clothing manufacturer in New Zealand.
Yeah.
She was telling me, not without a word of a lie, a man called her up to complain, and he started his complaint with, now look, I'm a man with a regular, he didn't use this word, but I'm going to say it. I'm a man with a regular sized wanger, a medium sized wanger, and none of your pants, all of your pants are too baggy at the front for me to fit my wanger out to urinate.
No.
He was complaining the pants were too baggy and he couldn't fit his wanger out the front of them.
Maybe he should just go back to buying kids' clothes.
Yeah, or you could just, there's so many ways around that you could pull your pants down, you could go to a store.
Just push your pants in towards your... How short is it?
Just go.
So many questions.
Honestly. Such a good complaint. And we want to know from you what the worst complaints you've ever heard are.
Sharon's on 0800 The Edge. Not me. It's another one. Hey, Sharyn.
How are you?
I'm great. It feels weird to say hi, Sharyn, to you. But what is your industry super secret?
Well, my husband is in the tyre industry.
Yeah.
And he had a complaint that the tyre was too black.
That's great.
That is ridiculous.
I like these tyres. Do they come in any other colours?
Would be pretty cool.
Black or blacker.
Would be pretty cool if you could get purple tyres, though.
Is there a market? There should be a market for that. Colourful tyres. Who would buy those? Hey, Sharyn, how weird was it when you talked to that person called Sharyn? Because you're called Sharyn.
That was a going to Matrix.
It was kind of weird.
Someone texted in to say, I work in the health industry, and a man called up and complained that he wasn't allowed to have sex with his wife in the bathtub. That's a good complaint. That's bollocks.
Royzen, what is yours?
I used to work for a chain of hotels in the UK.
Yeah.
And their marketing premise was, if you don't have a good night's sleep, you don't have to pay.
Yeah.
And we had a woman who woke up came to us in the morning and said that an earthquake that happened in the night had woken her up, so she didn't want to pay.
Hey, and to be honest, if that's in your positioning statement, that's fair enough.
I would try it.
I'd give it a go. How do we actually say your name?
Roisin.
Damn it. Good spelling, Chang. Thank you so much for calling.
0800 The Edge.
Caitlin, what's your submission?
Hi, I work at a supermarket and we had a lady come in and complain that she hadn't won Lotto before. And they have to take it seriously because it's a complaint.
Yeah, that's great.
And the customer is always right, aren't they? So it's hard. Oh. How did you talk her down from her ledge?
Oh, I was just like, oh, I'll just pass you on to someone else.
I'd be having that same complaint because I've been playing Lotto for a while now and I've still got a mortgage, which I'm not very happy about, babes.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't be playing it, to be honest.
just pass Sharyn on to someone else. Say, hey, look, I'll put you through to Hillary Timmons and we'll see what we can do.
I'll give you a call tomorrow. babe.
She'll look forward to it.
Well, why haven't I won Lotto yet? Like, how many tickets do I have to buy before I hit the big time?
Statistically, a lot.
My mum's been playing, as long as I can remember, she's never won anything. All I want is a car.
Let's call them up and complain.
Leisha, what is your industry super secret, the complaint line edition submission?
Mine is, well, when I worked in fast food as a teenager, we had a guy come back and demand a full refund and to talk to the manager because his lettuce in his burger was too cold.
I can imagine, I can agree with the brown lettuce, but like the lettuce is supposed to be cold, isn't it?
Yeah, otherwise hot lettuce is floppy.
Well, that's what we thought, but no, he wanted his money back.
Oh, God.
Did you just microwave his lettuce for him and slap it back in the burger?
We kind of looked at him like he was crazy.
Hey, Leisha, we've talked about this. Okay, it was a couple of years ago. Let it go. I'm sorry. I'm very, very sorry.
Can't get over it, guys.
Guys, Sharyn and Clint.
Itch.
Hello, Chang.
Hello, guys.
What's going on, mate? What are you cooking up over there?
Well, I thought this was going to be a brilliant thing to bring on the show.
Oh, brilliant. This is going to be good.
I read about this called Bulletproof Coffee.
Okay.
Which bulletproof coffee.
A crazy craze happening in the US right now where they add butter and coconut oil to coffee.
Gross. Why do they do that?
Apparently it's good for your system and it the coffee just expands, so it's instead of dying down real quick.
Last time my mum told me something was good for my system, it was this weird like spirulina like thick shake, and it gave me like explosive diarrhea.
Bulletproof coffee could do that to you as
it
well.
Cleansed
it. Bulletproof makes you shoot bullets.
I've read about this because the natural fats in the butter and the coconut oil are meant to stimulate your brain, like lubricate your brain, and it's meant to be like. I imagine bulletproof coffee works on you like those pills did on Limitless.
Good movie.
Now, you and I, Chang, love coffee.
I love coffee, yes.
Yeah.
I hate coffee.
Well, I know. We know, Guy Williams.
You don't drink it. You've got somewhat of a virgin palate, Guy.
Yeah.
We've given you coffee once before. If you are a long-suffering listener of the show, you might remember the first time Guy drank coffee.
I'm feeling bloody great about life.
He turned to us and he goes, guys, I don't know if it's a coffee talking, but was that legitimately the most incredible performance of your whole life? Like, was that the best thing that you've ever seen? And we didn't even pause, but to Guy it felt like we'd pause for eternity. He's like, why haven't you guys said anything?
I'm pranging on Ickies, guys. I'm high on coffee, I'm high on life.
He was dancing around the studio, he didn't know what was going on.
I actually am feeling a bit tired at the moment,
yep.
So this experiment could turn out well for me. Chang's concocting at the moment.
Chang, there's a screw top that thing.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, you're an idiot, mate. He's just banging on the top of it.
On there for you.
Okay, so yeah, the butter is supposed to be 2 tablespoons.
Yep, 2 tablespoons.
Chang's put in like 200 grams.
It's in a blender with a spoonful of coconut oil.
Yep.
We blew the budget on the coconut oil. Is that eating coconut oil? Is it stuff for like sex massages?
No, it's eating. Ooh, okay.
Now the stuff's just pouring out of the blender all over the desk. Chang said he didn't need newspaper. This is expensive radio equipment, mate.
Hang on. Yeah, hold on to that.
Now Clint is using a piece of A4 to stop the coffee from going onto the expensive radio equipment.
If you've broken my food processor, you're
going to
be very angry.
Hold the button down.
Thank you. Here we go. We're blending it up now.
Oh, yeah.
So it's coconut oil, butter, and coffee. I hate coffee, let alone coconut oil and butter.
Oh my God, this is a disaster.
Can we put some sugar in? Because
no sugar. No need for sugar.
There's sugar in the coconut oil.
Well, you've broken the food processor.
Don't say that.
Okay, hang on.
There's a wedding present.
You've never used it.
Whoever gave you that?
This is the first. You can't break it on the first use.
Whoever gave you this blender as a wedding present doesn't like you very much.
It smells. It was on our registry. We wanted it. It looked cool.
It smells amazing.
Hmm. Get into that, Guy.
Good luck, Guy.
So
okay, here it goes.
There's the taste test, but then there's the long-term effects.
Okay, here it shows skull up.
Yeah. Skull.
It's not nice to skull coffee.
Oh!
How does it taste?
Disgusting by the looks of it.
Don't throw it up.
Oh! Oh, that's not good. That is not good.
Let me taste it. As someone who actually likes coffee, let me taste it.
Not a good time. Oh, it's so sour.
It tastes like normal coffee that's a little bit buttery.
Oh, it's horrible.
He needs to finish it.
Terrific.
Finish it off, Guy.
This is terrible. What I'm not doing now is got, like, Clint's cooties on it.
No, no lip stocks.
You love his cooties.
It tastes like licking ass. Don't ask me how I know about that. I have licked a good ass in my time.
Okay, guys, guys, going to finish up that cup of coffee, and
it's bad.
We're going to do a live review of bulletproof coffee. We'll see what the effects are on Guy in about 15 minutes. Time. I'm really looking forward to this.
My guess is going to instantly send him to the bathroom.
If Guy leaves a voice break in the middle of it, you know why. Thanks, Chang. That was exciting.
Better living, everyone.
We'll fire the cash cannon next. It's the end.
Go clean my food processor. Properly.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the bloody edge.
It's time to fire the cash cannon.
Helmets on. The edge cash cannon is about to blow.
The cash cannon today is a little bit different. We've got three cannons, all three full of money, and we also have three listeners in studio with us that have been specially picked for registering on theedge.co.nz, and they have all already chosen a team member. So on my team from Northland, I've got Natasha. Welcome!
Hi.
How's it going?
I'm good, how are you?
Good. Now, how far along are you? You're pregnant.
I am pregnant. I'm 32 weeks.
32 weeks. Well, hopefully my cannon has got a lot of money in it.
Mummy needs some new nappies.
Is it safe to operate cash cannons when you're pregnant?
Sure is.
We'll soon find out.
She's like, I just want money. I don't give a damn.
My contestant's over here. Samantha, hello.
Hi.
You've got a cannon in your hand. Each of these cannons has a different amount. Are you confident that mine has a good amount of money in it?
Well, you promised me it did. So if you under-deliver, this is just not off.
Yeah, okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Guy's contestant all the way from... Where are you from?
Northland.
All the way from Northland. Where the hell's Northland?
North.
Up north.
Up from north of, or north of everywhere else in New Zealand. Welcome to the studio, Renata!
That kind of intro, I think you can let Renata fire her cannon first.
Yeah. Renata, you're stressed out, eh?
A little bit.
Why are you stressed out again? In case you don't get heaps of money, is what you said before.
Not at all. I think everyone should get a fair amount of money. That would be really nice.
I feel like someone's changed since the mics came on. Yeah.
Renata, you fire the cannon, babes. I'll stand here. Shoot it into my face. It's still
really?
Up. It's still
shoot
up.
It on the face.
Still up. Still
face.
Up.
Face.
How?
Just pull the trigger.
Pull the trigger.
Oh, no.
Grab that yellow piece of paper. That yellow piece of paper.
Renata, you have won
$500. Oh, Samantha, do you want to go next? All right, shoot this. Shoot it at Guy's face again.
No, get it in my face. She hit me in the head. She hit man down.
How much is that?
Oh, my God. It's
where'd it go?
She hit me in the head. She's sick.
Can you see it?
She said she's South African. She shot me in the face. It was Oscar Pretorius all over again.
I've let you down, mate. You've only got $100 out. That's all right. $100.
Hey, well done. And you shot me in the face as well. That is a good effort.
All right, we got Natasha's turn now. Also shoot that at Guy's face. Right at his face. How much has she won? No,
we've lost the money amount.
Hang on.
That you didn't shoot out all your money.
Yeah.
There's money everywhere in the studio. You have won
$300.
There you go.
Congratulations to everyone.
Oh, God. I didn't give you enough gas in that one. Sorry, Natasha.
There were two very limp firing cannons there. One was decent. Congratulations, girls. Some money for all of you. Thank you for playing the cash cannon.
Thank you.
If you want to play, you can go and register for it now at theedge.co.nz. It's time for a Guy, Sharyn and Clint Ask Me Anything.
And you can ask anybody. Go ahead and ask anybody. Yeah, you can ask anybody.
Everybody.
Anything.
Steve, you look stunned, mate.
Oh, man, this is... Wow.
Is that the most professional radio intro you've ever heard?
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. Yep.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the studio, Steve Dunstan from HUFFER!
In the middle of New Zealand Fashion Week, it's an honour to have you in here, and no doubt you are mental crazy at the moment.
Yeah, mental crazy. What a... Oh, it's always such a big week, you know?
Yeah.
We just... Why do we do this to us?
What shows have you checked out so far?
Do you know what? Only Stolen Girlfriends Club.
Oh, okay. That was the one they had, and it was at a track.
At the Speedway.
Yeah.
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 Awesome.
It was awesome. It was so cool. It was like up there in the stand. It was like, it really was a spectacle more so.
Now, Steve, you are the owner, founder, creator of one of New Zealand's most recognisable brands, HUFFER. We're doing an AMA. Are you ready for questions coming from left of field from anywhere?
Let's do this. Yep. Stick with me. We'll see what we can do.
All right. We've got our first question coming on 0800 The Edge. Nadia, what do you want to ask Steve?
What's his theory on why models who are more masculine in appearance are lacking women's curves and who are really tall are more sought after into the runway shows?
Yeah, there you go. The skinny model question straight away.
Yeah, it's a bit of a boring answer, but basically they're coat hangers. I mean, I don't know, I'm not the biggest fan of it, but they do, their garments just drape off their sticks, unfortunately.
Yeah.
That's a very interesting, I've never heard it put that way.
Yeah, because is it true, I was reading in a magazine and they said exactly what you said, that they're coat hangers that it's less distracting if people look at the clothes rather than the body?
Yeah, totally. I think, I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
My big question, I've been dying to ask you this all week, because HUFFER for me was first recognised, and sorry if you're offended by this, when Orlando Bloom wore it on the red carpet of Lord of the Rings. Was that for you and your business the moment when HUFFER blew up? Was that when everyone heard of it?
Or was it the time that Chris Martin wore it on stage at Big Day Out, with the first time Coldplay came here?
I reckon the Chris Martin one was cool of it.
Yeah.
I think, what you're saying, yes, the Orlando... happening was it was blown up at that stage, and that was sort of that was broadcasted, you know, to the public. It was on the front page of the Herald, I think. But it was, I mean, behind that, they didn't make it blow up, but that happened because it was blowing up.
Mm-hmm. I feel like you kind of ruined it, because the t-shirt was supposed to say "I love New Zealand" instead of said "I HUFFER New Zealand."
Yeah, we kind of fluked it, because I think Orlando was like pointing at the t-shirt, and he had a blazer on, and he's pointing at the t-shirt, and he's pointing out dots, but he was trying to say to the crowd, "I love New Zealand." So he kept doing it, and the crowd were going, "So he kept doing it," and
genius.
How'd you get the t-shirt to him?
Well, the story goes, I think their wardrobe lady, the costume designer or dresser that worked with him every day, got a gift for him.
Yeah.
Okay.
As a leaving gift.
Yeah. A New Zealand brand. Cool. We're doing an AMA with the man who founded and still runs HUFFER, Steve Dunstan. Steve, thanks for joining us, mate.
Oh, thanks for having me. It's great.
Someone's texted an AMA question. Why does Guy dress like a 90-year-old man?
I don't think he dressed like a 90-year-old man.
Looking good. Good red sneakers there.
Cool. Here's a good one from the text machine. How do brands like Alexander McQueen or Dolce & Gabbana justify their prices, like $500 for a scarf, $600 for a pair of glasses, $800 for a t-shirt, that sort of thing?
Yeah, they try and use like premium fabrics, but people get caught up in brands, right?
Do you think? Well, you run a brand, and a very successful brand here in New Zealand. What brands do you personally? Do you go outside HUFFER? Do you? What brands do you look up to? What brands do you like?
Yeah, well, anything. Well, I love brands, and I think something like North Face is pretty, you know, because they're very technical, and it's a sense of adventure.
Yeah, because I heard you started in like outerwear and like kind of rain jackets and that sort of thing.
Yeah, we did, and I think it's really exciting challenge to make technical purpose garments with. Purpose. Function is what we call it. HUFFER function, which is our outerwear.
Yeah,
it actually functions and does something, so it's like you're kind of getting something.
Yeah.
$800 pair of sunglasses, I don't know about that.
It's a bit full of, what is the one thing, like, since you've started HUFFER, when you think across everything that you guys have made, every design, what is the one thing that is your favorite piece that HUFFER have made?
That is a hard one. Maybe a classic down jacket, goose down jacket.
Yeah.
It's a lifesaver. And our office is so freezing down there. It's like we get this old theater, and it's seriously freezing. So yeah. It's a lifesaver. So it actually works for me.
So you design your clothes to wear in the office.
Well, if you're doing it in a theater, then you got it. Tina, what is your question?
I want to know why there's no regulation for the industry when it comes to sizing. Because, I mean, I'm not the smallest girl in the world, but I'm not huge either. And in some brands, I'm a 12, some I'm a 14, and some I go right up to a 16, which is crazy.
Well, that's a good point, especially with online, right? It's really hard to, how are you going to buy?
True.
And globally as well. Different continents and countries have different, different ways of doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, cause I got two t-shirts today online. They were both the same size, but one looked like it was for my husband, and one looked like it was going to be too small. But they were both considered a 12. It was crazy.
That is a good question, though. I've always wondered that as well.
There's a question here, and it says, "For you, what is the one item you'll never skimp on? Like, what's something you'll never go cheap on? Is there something that you'll always pay a premium for?
Knitwear and then outerwear as well. Like, if you have a jacket,
yeah,
and it's cheap, it can be 100% waterproof, but zero breathability. So it starts raining on the inside.
So, yeah. So you get all sweaty.
So you get a nice quality, waterproof, breathable fabric. So pay for it, you know? It's
good. Yeah, good point.
Adele, what do you want to ask Steve?
Can you sew? Like, did you do home ec and
question.
Stuff at school?
Yeah.
Can I say no, I can't.
Oh! You can't sew at all?
I'm not the designer.
Okay.
Yeah, so we have a design team. We have amazing designers, actually.
And do you just go in there and sort of sit down and go, I'm imagining this, I think it's going to look like this, and then someone has to wang that on a sewing machine for you?
Well, no. Like, for example, what we've released at Fashion Week, which is it's a brand called AIM, and it's designed in the HUFFER basement. So it's designed by our HUFFER team, and it's a high-end woman's line of luxurious fabrics. And it's more sophisticated and elegant and... But I was really passionate about having a product offering in that category.
Yeah.
So forging the vision for that instead of actually sitting down and doing the design, because we work with like Amy who designed it. She's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Getting people better than you. Isn't that what you're meant to do in business?
Most I think so. Definitely.
We've got one more round of questions with Steve from HUFFER and now Ask Me Anything.
And you can ask anybody. Go ahead and ask anybody. Yeah, you can ask anybody. Anything.
We got Nathan on the line who wants to ask Steve from HUFFER a question. What do you want to know, Nathan?
Oh, I just want to find out what it's been like working with Sly Guild and the Fashion Week.
Oh, yeah, good call. So that's actually this weekend, coming out the Fashion Weekend. We're doing a show, a collaborated show with Sly Guild, who are great guys from the North Shore in Auckland here. They are, that's cool.
Nathan, actually, that's a very specific question. Are you associated with Sly Guild?
Just an old mate that I used to go to school with, keep in touch every now and then.
Okay, cool, nice.
Yeah, keep getting in touch, Jay, so you can get some free clothes, Nathan.
Oh, yeah, definitely tried to.
Mate, that plug is worth a full outfit, I reckon, so hit him up.
Yeah, ask him, you got to ask him. Jamie, what do you want to know?
How you going? Years ago, I got a HUFFER t-shirt given to me as a present. It was actually for my 21st. And ever since then, my little nephews and sister and family have always called me Uncle HUFFER.
That's awesome.
Yeah, and I've also got the number plate HUFFER, and I've had it for years and years, and I've just recently taken it off a vehicle not long ago.
So, you're trying to sell it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Have you rung up to hock a second-hand personalised plate?
I believe the spelling's incorrect there, though.
Spelling is incorrect.
Jamie, it was worth a try, but
good
crack.
I think, good on him.
I think probably it's a no. Is it
deal,
right,
deal or no deal, Steve?
Well, actually, to be honest, not on my car, but I have to.
Uncle HUFFER, it's all good.
Thanks, Uncle HUFFER.
Thanks, Uncle HUFFER. Really appreciate it. On that note of that brand you're doing it with, is there any upcoming New Zealand startup brands that you'd like to recommend to people?
Yeah, or Sly Guild being one of them. I mean, they're more...
Are they called Sly Girl or Sly Guild?
Guild, sorry.
Guild.
Yeah. Sly Guild. Check them out. They're good guys. Men's, streetwear. But it's premium streetwear. They make really nice quality, good denim.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I love those guys. This is a plug about them.
Chang is a big advocate of this brand, and I want to know if there's any in your wardrobe. Are you rocking any Ed Hardy in 2014?
Oh, God.
No, but we're in Newmarket in Auckland here. We quite proudly took their store when they...
Good
effort.
You broke Chang's bedazzled little heart when you did that.
We had to peel all the glitter off the walls.
You would still be finding glitter in that shop. My goodness.
Another question from Chang. What are your thoughts on three-quarter pants? Hot or not?
The ones you're wearing?
Yeah. Well, the ones he wears every day. Chang doesn't own a full-length pair of pants.
Or shorts, just three-quarter everything.
If it keeps your knees warm,
Yeah, and great in an ankle-height flood.
Okay, so the big question, the big serious question we're getting from the text machine, because there's thousands of kids in New Zealand going through fashion school every year, desperate to get into the industry. What's your best advice for people who want to break into the fashion industry?
Yeah, good question. Just believe in... I mean, it's pretty simple stuff. Just believe in yourself, back yourself. Make sure you're passionate. If you're not, just pull out. Don't do it. But talk to people. I think this industry is relatively small and very very helpful.
Sure.
I mean, when I have time, I love to help if I can, you know? Like, yeah. Yeah, I think if you ask, sometimes you get, right? So definitely talk to the industry. It's not hard to get through to people.
You know? Do you think it's easier or harder for people to start up now in the age of the internet?
Kind of easier. You can start a brand on Instagram, right?
Yeah, you can. Yeah, and you don't have to have a store, I guess.
So do you think they? Do you think people? Because you can tell I'm trying to start my own brand up here, Cool Guy Clothing. Do you think I should start working for a brand, or I should start stitching some t-shirts out the back of my house?
Yeah, go to the back of the house.
Back of the house?
Learn the hard way.
Yeah, okay.
I reckon.
Start from scratch? I like it.
Get your little brother in there.
Kiwi ingenuity, get some kids in there, stitching some clothes. What are your thoughts on sweatshops, by the way? Keen? For them or against them?
Obviously against, but there has been sweatshops in New Zealand.
Has there really?
Well, a long time ago, I went to a factory and immigration's there asking questions.
Oh, weird. Okay, well, I know HUFFER stays a long way away from that. You've got a big show on Sunday, Steve. Best of luck to it. Steve from HUFFER, we really appreciate you coming. Give him a round of applause.
If you'd like to get amongst that show, it could be your little taste of New Zealand Fashion Week. Check out iTicket. Just give New Zealand Fashion Week and HUFFER a Google, and you can actually buy tickets to be there in the Viaduct Event Centre this Sunday at 3 o'clock.
Yep, that's right. Watch the catwalk right there. Be part of it.
Nice. Steve from HUFFER, everybody.
Steve Dunstan!
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the Edge.
It's time to meet two more dudes who want to marry each other to go and watch some rugby.
The Edge. Love you, man. The hunt for New Zealand's ultimate bromance is on.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the studio, direct from Central Dunedin. Is that a place?
Dunedin would be...
Roughly Dunedin, the wonderful, the amazing Travis and Matt!
Cheers, guys. Thanks for the welcome.
Yeah, well, thanks for having us.
Thanks so much for being here with your beautiful beards. We've got a long beard and we've got a short beard. I've got to ask you an awkward question.
Ooh.
Are you guys brothers? Because you look very, very similar. And I'm thinking, is I Love You Man going to go to a whole new level because it's going to be two dudes that are best friends and brothers getting married?
We do say I love you, bro, but that does not mean we're brothers. We have had this conversation.
You look like brothers.
Yeah, we're extremely good looking.
Yeah.
Are you worried that at the wedding, if you kiss, your beards will Velcro together?
Yeah.
Honestly, it won't be the first time, actually. And
what have you found in there? Honestly.
Well, like, what has
honestly?
He had in there?
Yeah, what have you found in there?
A few chips here and there.
Yeah. Chips.
Travis, can I ask, how did you find out that you were entering the competition? Like, what was that like?
Oh, well, on a Sunday morning, pretty hungover, I got a phone call from Matthew, and I was, oh, how's it going, Matt? What do you want? He's like, hey, weird question, bro. Will you marry me? yeah, sure, man. Why?
I love that the questions came after. But
yeah. You already agreed before that. Did you have like a girlfriend lying next to you in bed or anything like that?
No.
Look at
not
the beard,
a girlfriend.
Look at the beard. Don't ask dumb questions.
Matt, the beard normally goes alright, actually.
Matt, was Travis your first choice, or did you ask someone else first?
No, Travis was my first choice.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Good answer. Hit him on speed.
Yeah, always got to go with that answer.
Hit him on speed dial and everything.
Yeah.
And what does your mum think about this?
Mum's pretty good with it, actually. It turns out I've got a couple of pretty hip parents.
You know, really?
Really would have thought that they'd be dead against it.
Yeah.
But, no,
are they Southerners as well?
Yeah, they're Southerners as well. I mean, I'm not going to lie, Mum was not too keen on it to begin with. But as the days have gone on, her worries sort of shifted more away from Travis and I potentially getting married, becoming a wedding couple, to what she might wear on the wedding, potential wedding day. Yeah. So,
what about dads?
Well, I actually haven't told the old man yet.
You haven't told him?
There's no point worrying him until we know what's happening.
Yeah, that's fair enough.
What does your mum think? Have you told her?
Yeah, I told her. She absolutely laughed her head off, and she's cracked a few jokes at me.
As she would. Squash is a good lady.
Should we give her a call and see what she thinks? Find out how she really feels.
Oh, yeah, great.
All right, well, let's call
I'd
her
love
now.
To hear from you.
Suzanne, is that your mum?
Yeah.
Mum is Suze.
Suzanne.
So where will she be right now?
At work, Dunedin.
Okay.
Oh, that's good. Good year.
Credits.
Who's speaking?
Hello, Suzanne.
Hello, what's happening?
Not a lot. You're actually on the radio right now.
Hi, Mum is Suze.
Oh, hi.
Hello.
So, Suzanne, it's Guy, Sharyn, Clint here. Welcome to the program. We're calling you because have you heard that you're lucky enough that your son may be getting married?
Yes, I am.
have you heard the details of his marriage? Because he may be marrying another man.
Yes, I'm happy with Matt.
are you happy with him, though?
I'm happy with Matt.
Is this how you envisioned your son getting married?
Honestly, be honest with us.
No.
I'd be happy to accept Matt.
Oh, that's so romantic.
Thanks so much, Squash.
Is that because no girl's ever going to be good enough for him, Suze?
Dead right.
Now, Trav just told us that he hasn't told his dad yet. How do you think he's going to feel about this situation? Or does he know?
Probably would not say a lot. I've just got one thing to say.
Yeah.
If they do marry, does that mean that Matt gets a share of the freezer as well?
What is the freezer? Let me know.
I just rock up to Suzanne's when I'm a bit broke and steal everything out of the freezer.
Oh, okay. If you want, we'll write it into the prenuptial agreement.
I'd appreciate that.
Okay, good. All right, we're just calling to check you're on board. So you're all good with it?
Yeah, absolutely. Can't wait.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Suzanne.
See you guys.
Bye. All right, see you, Squash. Bye-bye.
Bye, Mum. Love you.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, everyone's got to vote for these guys. It's Matt and Trevor.
Thanks, guys.
Good luck, lads. Another couple of finalists tomorrow morning with JJ, Mike and Dom.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint
on The Edge.
In case you haven't noticed, it's been a tense day in Guy, Sharyn, Clint studios today. It's been awkward. There's been a debate going since about 2 p.m. Now, last night, it was announced, and this is huge news, that Aqua, the band from the 90s that Shazdog loves, is coming to New Zealand. I love them too. Who doesn't love them? They're a great band.
Me.
I got an email before that they're coming to New Zealand. They're doing a show at the Power Station in Auckland the 29th of October. You can get tickets from Ticketmaster from Tuesday, and they're only $66.
Chang doesn't even like them, and he's got terrible taste in music.
Whatever.
$66 is so much, though.
No, it's not.
To see Aqua.
Hanson was 85, and they only have 2 songs.
Yeah, good
These
point.
Guys have heaps of songs. And I got an email from an anonymous co-worker that just said, just heard Chang trying to get rid of your 2-minute Aqua montage with the programming department.
Okay.
I told them no, but he would not listen to
me. Here's the problem, all right? Shazdog at 2 p.m. went into Chang's studio, was in there for an hour crafting a 2-minute-long Aqua montage.
And it's a good montage because it gives you a chance to sing along.
Okay, but here's the thing. We have a 56-second montage which has all the same songs in it and does the job just as well.
But every time you just get into the song, it'll be like, Dr. Jones, Jones, and you're like, oh, calling Dr. Jones. You don't even get to the chance to call Dr. Jones because that's just on Dr. Jones, Jones, call.
For 4 hours, this debate has been going back and forth. This is tense. Shazdog wants a 2-minute montage. Clint wants a 55-second one.
What do you want?
We're going to come at... I want 2 minutes, yes, to be honest. You need 2 minutes of pure Aqua, I reckon.
Well, let's get someone to call now and decide on the phone. 0800 The Edge. Do you want the 2-minute montage or the 1-minute montage?
Break the tiebreaker.
Or no montage.
That's
an option.
Okay, we've got someone already.
No montage.
On 0800 The Edge.
No Aqua. No Aqua.
Shut up, Clint. Hello, caller, listener, friend.
Hi,
do you want the 2-minute montage or the 1-minute montage?
I want the 2-minute one.
2-minute montage!
All right.
Strap yourselves in. We're going to Funky Town.
Barbie girl!
Here begins the worst 2 minutes of The Edge today.
My favourite thing about this took Shazdog 45 minutes at least to do.
Well, let's listen to it. Sure.
Songs about being happy boys and happy girls.
Just let it play.
The drums are exactly the same on every song.
Time.
This is a classic. We've got to be running our songs, though, eh?
No, we're only at the 1-minute mark. There can't be any more Aqua songs. Wait, does Barbie Girl feature again?
You're ruining it. You're ruining it.
Can we just cut it off there?
Sharyn is the only person. Sharyn's the only person who knows the song. Ladies and gentlemen, that was a 2 minute. No other radio station will do that. A 2 minute aqua montage.
I spent 15 minutes on the change between Dr. Jones and my Omai, and Clint effing spoke over it.
Goals.
Jesus Christ.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on the Edge.
Just saw an amazing photo on the interwebs. It's Sean Johnson. Sharyn, you'll be into this big time.
Oh, yeah.
Sean Johnson.
I love dudes, eh? Whoa, yeah, dudes!
No. Well, you do. That's the thing. You're being sarcastic. Yeah,
you're taking the piss out of one of the stereotypes about you that you constantly reinforce by your constant... What are you doing? Are you having sex with the chair?
No.
Because you love dudes so much.
I'm just excited about talking about dudes.
Don't say it sarcastically, because you actually love talking about dudes that you love so much.
Yeah, but... I've never talked about Sean Johnson.
Front page of stuff.com.nz was had a picture of Sean Johnson rocking Ben Don underwear. He's the ambassador. He's looking super sexy in his underwear. And now obviously what they've decided, and this is something that they do with Dan Carter as well, is like rugby players look good in underwear, we'll use them to front our campaign.
Yeah.
I don't look good in underwear. I look okay in underwear, don't want to brag about it, but I don't look good.
You look good from like the waist up. Waist down's like, oh really? He's so tall.
Those legs are so long. It's like a half giraffe, half man.
My take on you is good from afar, but far from good.
So it's like they say on Clueless, you're a Monet.
So I was wondering what could I like endorse? What could be like my brand representation? And I have a massive head, so I think maybe I could be like a hat endorser, like remember the Von Dutch Trucker Cap Corporation?
Yeah.
I regret putting a lot of money into Von Dutch shares a long time ago.
I don't think you could represent any kind of headwear.
No, I Why think not? He'd look pretty cool.
Because I don't believe that one size fits all applies to you.
Should write a letter and going, hey guys, this is no longer true. I've actually had one size fits all hats that haven't fit me.
Of course you have,
but
mate.
That's why I'd be such a good ad campaign.
Yeah, and you would look so cute going around in your Jeep Wrangler with Paris Hilton and your fake tan and be like, that's hot, babs.
I would look so good because people would be like, wow, he's got a huge head and he fits that cap. I'm going to buy a cap like that.
If I saw you endorsing hats, I would have thought it's like that clothes store for really tall people. I'd be like, oh!
Big and tall.
There's a hat. Yeah. There's a hat for people with huge heads.
Yeah, the big and tall hat.
I wouldn't think it would fit mine.
If you guys could use one of your attributes.
Cheeseburger.
Okay, well, I didn't even finish the sentence, but you're going to endorse cheeseburgers.
Yeah.
Do they need endorsing? Is the world not over already, like, sold on cheeseburgers? No, does that need advertising?
My dream, my absolute dream.
Yeah.
Before I die, I want to have... I want to endorse a burger.
Okay.
Because
like Kate Upton.
No, I wouldn't want to do it. I would want an actual good burger, not just a burger and a rubble over my body.
No, those Carl's Jr. burgers are good.
Yeah, but I wouldn't want to do an ad like that. I want a serious cheeseburger ad. My husband's in a burger ad, okay. And he's taking my dream.
Do it now. Do it now. Do me your serious cheeseburger ad.
Steamed bun, beef, tomato, cheese, pickle, mayonnaise, red onion. This is the best burger of your life. Get it in your gob, you sausage.
I'll tell you what my problem is there.
Shivers, I know what you're going to say. I forgot to say the condiments. Mayonnaise. Mayonnaise. What is tomato sauce? Get it in your gob, sausage.
You didn't even tell me where to get the burger.
Well, I haven't got someone to endorse it for yet.
Hey, if you want to endorse Sharyn...
Shaz Dog's Burger Shack. Get it in your gob, you sausage.
I'm Sharon's PR That's person. Email me, guy@theedge.co.nz. If you want to pay Sharyn to endorse your burger, she will do that for you, and she'll be awesome. She's got the ad all prepared
and
stuff.
That's my catchline, though. Will get it in your gob, you sausage.
Will you do it in a bikini like Kate Upton?
Do I look like I would look good in a bikini?
I think
and
you would.
Now, yes. I'm going to do it in my sweatpants.
If you've got any bikini pics, send them to guy@theedge.co.nz.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint. Edge.
I've got a question for you guys.
What is the question?
Have you done the milkshake challenge yet?
Yes, I have.
No.
I've nominated you two and Dom Harvey from The Breakfast Show. Who's done it?
I've done it.
Yes!
I did it last night in my bathtub.
What did you do?
I basically poured milk on myself and shaked, like the challenge suggests.
As it obviously says.
Yeah, did you get creative?
I did it to the tune of Jason Derulo Wiggle. You know what to do with that big fat butt.
It's literally...
Wiggle.
It's literally... I wouldn't recommend watching Clint's video. It's literally the most disgusting thing I've ever seen.
What?
It's just a fully grown man lying in a bathtub, covered in milk, squirming around like some sort of demented worm.
Yeah. Do you know what I'm hearing in
people
that?
People Google that stuff, you know?
I'm hearing...
That's a fetish.
I'm hearing someone that hasn't done the milkshake challenge, so... One of these things just don't belong here. Until you do it.
I can't be screwed doing it. I don't want to do it. It sucks.
Well, my milkshake challenge...
Don't be such a hater.
My milkshake challenge is on our Facebook page right now.
Yep, facebook.com/edgeafternoons. And tomorrow we will have guys.
Who are we donating the money to again?
Breast cancer. How much did you donate?
I'll go and do it now. I don't know. How much is it? 10 bucks?
Yeah, 10, 20, 20 bucks, mate.
All right, I'll go and do it now.
Guy, you've got to do 50 because you're last.
Today's Guy, Sharyn and Clint podcast is brought to you by Grass. Perfect for gardens and sport. Get grass today from your friendly grass vendor.